Our success is related to the coverage of the fiber and optical, the optical fiber and cable TV networks, as well as to the coverage of the LTE networks. It is related mainly, from the regulatory point of view, to the imposition of asymmetric access to the ducts and poles of Portugal Telecom. It was a measure taken by ANACOM almost 9 years ago, and it was an important factor in reducing the cost of investing in broadband networks. A second set of measures was a law published by the government, a government law published in 2009. That law clearly anticipates the recent directive of the European Union, Directive 61/2014, in that it sets the principles for access to ducts and poles owned by other utilities and other municipalities in the country. Other utilities meaning electricity companies, water and waste companies, highway operators, railway operators, and municipalities. So these were the main milestones concerning regulation. But the dynamics of competition in the domestic market were also very important. Portugal Telecom that made the spin-off of their cable TV business, and as a result of that, they had to build from scratch a pay TV service, and that was a driver for a huge investment in broadband. And recently, the launch of 4P bundles meant that mobile operators understood that they need a nationwide broadband business, and fixed operators understood that they needed a nationwide mobile business. So these are the main because of that, mobile operators have been investing, as Vodafone, or there has been a merger between the largest cable TV operator and the smallest mobile operator. Of course, when setting asymmetric access to ducts, we were aware that deep regulatory involvement would be needed, not only in relation to the prices, but in relation to the SLA agreements and setting the appropriate SLA agreements so that they are fair and proportional, but they do not maybe they cannot be the source of barriers to entry is certainly one of the main challenges. Another main challenge that we have nowadays is, of course, how to implement the recommendation of the recommendations of the European Commission on access to next generation networks and on the costing of on the costing of access to next generation networks. The infrastructure was funded by the companies in general, so either by equity, of course, or by debt. I guess that in most cases, of course, it was by debt. But there was a small part of the infrastructure that was co-financed by the government. In rural and poor areas, there was a public tender to select an operator that would build an optical fiber network covering at least 50% of the population in these poor municipalities. In these areas, the investment was co-financed with public funds. They represent a relatively small part of the population. Well, it seems inevitable. Market consolidation, of course, has the traditional reasons that we find in other industries, taking advantage of economies of scale, avoiding cost duplication. These are the traditional reasons for mergers, and they apply to national mergers and to cross-border mergers in this industry. But there are also other reasons for other types of consolidation that relates to the dynamics of the telecommunications and information technologies markets. And so we see telecom operators integrating into content delivery networks or integrating into the production of content. We see content producers integrating into CDNs. So there is also a merger wave that is the result of technological change and of the perception of companies that merging they can increase their profits, of course, using current resources, and they can rationalize their investments. In my country, that's where I can talk, mandatory infrastructure sharing is focused on ducts, on poles, and eventually on other elements of civil engineering that may be able or that can be used to co-locate electronic communications equipment on a mandatory basis. Of course, there are also agreements between the operators, mainly mobile operators, to share some facilities, including masts, to co-locate their antenna. That's one other source of facility sharing. In Portugal, there is also another case of facility sharing that is related to optical fiber. Two mobile operators, Vodafone and Optimus, before the merger, agreed on developing on covering 500,000 homes, but they agreed on sharing the infrastructure. So there is a case in Portugal also of operators sharing the fiber on a voluntary basis that involves no regulation. After the merger of Optimus with the cable TV operator, sharing that infrastructure with Vodafone became mandatory. But in the beginning, that sharing process was voluntary between the two companies. We see that people are increasingly choosing whenever they can. In principle, they choose cable or fiber in relation to ADSL. But in Portugal, the main technology that is being chosen by consumers to have access to broadband services is still ADSL. Portugal Telecom provides triple play solutions with ADSL, so including IPTV. Same applies to Vodafone. In the case of Vodafone, in most cases, using the local loop rented to Portugal Telecom. So ADSL is still used by a large percentage of Portuguese consumers. In many cases, they have a debit rate, or the speed is, let's say, or the promised speed, of course, it depends on the hour of the day, goes to 20 megabits per second, 25 megabits per second, 24 megabits per second. But in many cases, that speed is not reached. Usually what the operators do sometimes is the following. When they cable a home where there is a customer having already an ADSL service, they change from the ADSL to the fiber or cable service without additional charges. Some cases, this change involves basically maintaining the same speed. Although the speed could increase, they maintain the same speed and there are no additional charges. In other cases, the speed increases up to the normal speed of, let's say, 80 megabits per second, 90, 100, up to 100 megabits per second.